Okay, for today we're going to talk about solar thermal system design. The purpose of this is to talk through good methods for designing a solar system, what a good solar system design looks like. We're going to go through some system types. As anyone who's followed our blog knows, we are advocates of drainback technology, and we're going to discuss why. We're going to talk about collector arrays and how to pipe them. And we're going to talk a little bit about controls at the end. So the first thing we want to talk about are fundamentals. How do we collect energy? How do we store it? How do we pipe the collector arrays? How do we get the energy from the solar tank into the load? And what does a complete system look like? So let's start out with system attributes. If you could close your eyes and design a perfect solar system, solar thermal system, what would the attributes be? What would it look like? Well, we wouldn't want any boiling or freezing problems. We would like to use less expensive equipment than pressure vessels, when we'd like to not have to bump into ASME codes. If we can skip glycol, that's better. Glycol is something that costs money. It ages. It turns into acids. It eats pipes and things. If we could not have to use it, that would be better. Glycol also has a specific heat capacity in solution of about 85% that of water. So it's not as efficient as water as a heat transfer agent. So if we could skip using glycol, we'd be better off. If we could eliminate air vents and check valves and PRVs and expansion tanks and all of those components that add expense but do not add one whit to the performance of a system. They keep it from breaking, but they don't add any energy. And in fact, they waste a lot of energy because most of them are uninsulated, sitting out in the room or out in the ambient, dumping heat out of the system. If we could eliminate the need for any kind of heat dump or nighttime dumps, pool dumps, steam backs, if we could eliminate the need for those guys, we would eliminate a lot of auxiliary equipment, controls, pumps, things that run those. Remember, all of that stuff dies when the power fails, so the best heat dump in the world is useless if you have a power failure. Which brings up point number six, is power failure. We would love for the system, if the power goes down, and it's going to go down sooner or later on any system, we'd like for that to be what I call a normal operating mode, meaning it doesn't do a thing to the system. It's something the system does periodically anyway as part of the control mode. Other items down there, number seven, no heat exchanger between the collectors and the tank. Why is that important? We're going to have a heat exchanger between the tank and the load, but we'd like not to have it between the collectors and the tank. Who cares where it is? Well, I care, and maybe there's a good reason for it. One is, if we can capture all of the energy that the collectors generate and put that energy in storage, minus a couple of percent line losses, but if we can get all of that energy in the tank, then all we have to be concerned about is how to get it out. If we never get it in the tank in the first place, it's gone forever, and it doesn't matter whether we can get it out or not, we don't have it. We lost it. So my philosophy is that we want to get all the heat in the tank we possibly can. So that eliminates the collector to tank heat exchanger, its cost, its placements, its operation, and so forth. It would also be nice if this system could be scaled to any size, from tiny to humongous. The smallest system I ever made was 12 gallons, and the biggest now is thousands of gallons. The scale, the diagram, piping diagram and everything is identical on all of those different system sizes. Everything just gets bigger or smaller. So if we can achieve these eight attributes, these eight prerequisites, what do we get from it? Well, obviously we get fewer components. A few components makes a more reliable system. If we can use water, we can get 15% more efficiency out of the heat transfer fluid to start with. We get a longer life of the system. We don't have to maintain any glycol. Keep the tank, some water in the tank, and keep the pumps running, and we keep right on going. System life with glycol usually goes down by about 30% according to third-party comments. And obviously without all those parts, without the glycol, without the acid corrosion, we get lower maintenance. That's good. And this scalable thing comes out as large system works just like small ones. So how do we do this stuff? Well, let's talk about the drainback system. We're going to talk about the collectors, the tank, a pump, and controls. We'll talk about the controls later, so we won't worry about when and how we turn the pump on. So first off, let's say sun comes up in the morning and we want to turn this system on. The diagram there shows the solar tank. It shows a vent in the tank. It's a meaning it's a atmospheric pressure vessel with a hole in it. The tank is not quite full of water. There's an air gap at the top. And we've got a very simple piping line from the cold water at the bottom through the pump up to the bottom of the collectors, fills up the collectors, and it spills back down the return line back in the tank. So we want to heat the water maybe 15 to 20 degrees per pass through the collectors. Now, that delta T going through the collectors will vary all over the place from a high of maybe 40 down to cause zero when it's time to turn the system off. Another item that's important is a lot of people say, well, okay, we got to pump the whole head from the pump place and the floor up to the top of the collector, maybe five stories up in the air. I would love to decrease the horsepower of that pump by having the return line be a siphon return. A siphon return means that the water falling in the return line will suck water up the supply line and the pump horsepower goes down. The problem with that is we tried this in the 80s, some engineers and I, professional engineers and I, and we never could make it work. You could get it to siphon in the morning when it was a relatively cool temperature and the density of the water was high and you didn't have any air bubbles in the water, and by afternoon when everything was good and hot and you were boiling the dissolved gases out of the water and the viscosity of the water had changed, you didn't have siphon return anymore. It became a nightmare, and we decided to abandon any attempt to make a siphon return on the return line and just simply size the return as the same size as the supply, and we never had any problems with that. And it turns out that the argument about what a high pump head you have to have and how much horsepower you have to have in the pump turns out to be a small consideration. It doesn't really give you a lot of grief, and so it's just simpler to do it this way. It's easier to do it this way, and the penalty is minimal. So we got this system running all day long. We're pumping water through the bottom. It's spilling back in the tank, blub, blub, blub. At the end of the day, or rain shower, or cloudy cover, or whatever, when we can't gain heat from the collectors, we turn the pump off, the collector pump. You just simply shut the thing off. The water coming down the return line has that air gap at the bottom, and it just goes glub, 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 and drains itself free. So there's no water in the return line after a little bit. And the return line is the great big air vent, and the rest of the water just drains backwards through the collectors, back through the pump, back in the tank. If you turn the pump off, the water cannot stay in the collectors. There's no way. So a power failure is a normal operating mode. You're going to do that every day, regardless. And if you have a rain shower or some other event that clouds the collectors come by, the pump turns off, the water drains back. Now, this feature, the fact that you can turn the system off, you can get the water out of the collectors, there's no boiling or freezing at that point, that means that you can shut the system down if you need to because the tank has gotten so hot that one of two things is true. Either nobody's using the hot water, or if you're using the hot water, the tank doesn't get that hot, you take it out. So when a tank gets really hot, that means you're not using it. The second thing is we don't want to go beyond a certain temperature limit because a lot of the downstream use, you may be supplying scalding water. If there's no tempering system down below, you could start supplying dangerously high temperature water. So there's this level of temperature in the solar tank that means you're not using it. Why keep running it and wasting energy, wasting power when you're just not using any of it? The efficiency is going down and down in the loop. So we just turn the thing off when the tank reaches a high limit. Now, a typical high limit is 160 degrees, and that's usually measured toward the bottom of the tank. It means the top might be as much as 180 or so. I've seen high limits as high as 190. I think those people were just trying to stay a little bit away from boiling. But somewhere in the 160-degree range is what we recommend for the high limit on the solar tank. Again, you're not really losing any energy because if it's that hot, you're not using it in the first place. So let's move right along. How to drain the collectors. Now that we've got the modus operandi established, how it works, let's talk about some details. We want the collectors to drain, obviously, and all the piping between the collectors and the tank. We have to be very careful at the collectors that we establish a very slight drain slope, and it's not much. An inch and 20 feet is just fine. It is not a quarter inch per foot as you do for drain and waste piping. That is way too much. You'll have one end way up in the air, and there's another reason you don't want to do it. You see the down stub up there at the upper left part of the picture, upper right, excuse me. There's always in every bank of collectors one stub in that's downhill. If you slope the collectors too much, that down stub is going to fill up with water, and then at night it's not going to drain out of there, and at night it's going to freeze and pop the pipe. So we don't want too much drain slope, because we'll put too much water in the down stub. We will create a freeze problem at that point. We have a solution for that, but I won't bore you with it at this point. If you really have to run the collectors down the roof, say you've got a ridge line that's north-south, and you've got to get on either on the west roof or the east roof to look at the sun, you're going to have a down stub that's really down then. And there are ways to put silicon rubber plug in there to prevent water from filling up that down stub and freezing things. So let's go back to this diagram. You see that B and A represent the lowest incoming point to the array, and A is the highest point in the return. I like to think of A as the continental divide. That's where the water will flow backwards through the collectors if you go one way, or down the return line if you go the other. It is the highest point of the system. It's an important point on any kind of solar piping. Once you get away from the collectors, use maximum slope down to the tank. There are situations where people are running through buildings down corridors, and again, they have to use the minimum drain slope of an inch and 20 feet. But if you can, you use as much slope as you can possibly get. By the way, glycol systems should do this anyway to make the air bubbles go up to the top of the line. And some glycol people say that they don't have to worry about their piping, but a lot of them get vapor locked if they don't worry about their piping. There are three angles that we talk about on a collector array. The obvious angle is pointing the collector south. That's called south azimuth. Normally, due south is called zero, and east is called minus something, minus 10 degrees, minus 15, and west is called plus 15 degrees, 20 degrees, whatever. That's the conventional way to represent the south azimuth for solar. Then we tilt the collectors up from the horizon, and we call that just the tilt. The slope that we've just been talking about to make them drain, we call the drain slope. So to keep the language from being very confusing, we need to recognize there are three angles we're talking about: the azimuth, the tilt, and the drain slope. That helps keep us from being too confused when we're talking to each other. All right, let's go through some arrangements now, collector arrangements. We define a bank of collectors as a group of collectors that are soldered directly to each other. We call that a bank. So you can have rows that have different banks in them, different rows. If you look at the top drawing there, you'll see five collectors with the line at B being the low point and A being the high point. This is called a reverse return. You go in lower left, you come out upper right. And reverse return means the following. If you were to follow a molecule of water starting from B and winding up at A, and follow it through any possible path in any one of those collectors, into collector number one, up tube number four, out the header, and over to A, all of those path lengths are identical. Every possible geometric path length from B to A is identical. That's what reverse return results in. It helps balance the collectors, give uniform flow to every collector, and it works very well. That means you don't have to have any more balancing valves than necessary. Now, the bank size, people say, how many collectors can I put in a row? Manufacturers generally tell you that, but a lot of times I don't agree with the manufacturer for this reason. They may be talking about balanced flow and how many collectors you can put and still get fairly uniform flow between them. Collectors are not perfect. No two collectors are exactly identical. If you put too many in a row, you'll start getting natural imbalances, higher flow right through this one, lower flow right through that one. I think most manufacturers are considering that. My consideration is entirely different. I think the expansion and contraction is the bigger problem. If you've got 4 foot wide collectors, the ones that we typically use are 50 and a half inches from tip to tip. If you put 10 of those in a row, you've got 50 some feet straight copper pipe in the manifolds inside those collectors. And think about it. The collectors are going to go from the absolute lowest coldest temperature in the winter to stagnation empty temperatures in the summer. So if you live where my daughter does in Wilmer, Minnesota, it can go to 60 below every 10 years. It can go to 40 below every 5 years and 30 below every year. In the summertime, it can go to 100 degrees. So if you've had one of those high limit things we previously talked about, your collector's sitting there with no water in it, the ambient's 100 degrees, the collector guts will probably go up to 250, maybe even 300 degrees. We've seen them regularly here in Raleigh go to 210. And the piping seems to drain off the energy, so they don't quite get to 300. So you're going to swing from 50 below zero to 200 degrees. That's a 250-degree swing on 50 feet of copper pipe. You're likely to tear the system to pieces. So I don't like too many collectors, mainly for that expansion and contraction reason. If you say, well, good, I'll go down to three collectors or four, that's fine. It'll work just fine. You have a whole lot of piping, as you'll see. So there's some pretty good numbers in there in the 25 to 30 foot range. So if you've got 5 4-footers or 6 4-footers, that's okay. I wouldn't do 7, 8, 9, 10. So let's move on to how we do some more complicated collector piping. Here we're showing one row with two banks, 2 5 collector banks. The principles are identical to what I said earlier. You pipe the two in parallel to each other. The same rule applies. If you follow a molecule of water from any path in bank one or bank two, any tube and any collector from A to B, you'll get identical geometric path distance. So that is a self-balanced system. All the collectors must fill before any one of them can drain. Imagine that you're taking this bank, this row of collectors, and dipping them in the ocean. In other words, as the banks go down and water rises up the banks, that's equivalent to turning on the pump and filling them up. You want that point A to be the last thing to be seen before the water dumps. So that's one way I look at it. It may not suit everybody. Here's how to do an over and under. I said same piping, you pipe them in parallel. Supplies are in parallel, returns are in parallel. Notice that the return line from row one does not fall back down. It goes up and joins the return line from row two. This is what makes row one has to fill up. All the water has to fill to point A before anything can dump. Again, this is a reverse return diagram. The path length from B to A for any possible path is identical, and that makes them self-balanced. Well, there are more complicated things than that. We can do two rows of two banks, and this is basically just a combination of the previous ones. All the same principles are involved. The path difference down there from the B, which isn't shown, to A, which is shown, is still identical for all path lengths. This slide here came from an engineering drawing on a military project. The engineer is not a military engineer, but was a contractor to the military. And a contractor wanted to install this system, wanted to bid on it, and he sent me this the spec package that included these diagrams saying, can you help me define the system, the components? And I looked at these drawings and said, oh boy, it's time to call this engineer. And the two things we do with the engineer, we politely tell them that we see some better ways to do it than they've done it, and there are two opportunities. One is to either fix what they've got or just offer an alternative so they don't have to touch their old work. They just have to look over an alternative set of plans and approve the alternative as being okay. Well, let's look at this. This is what came in the door, and I looked at that. Let's walk through it. Here's the piping shown in red. And as you can see, that's a rat's nest of piping. I have yet to figure out exactly how the flow will go through that thing. The little red circles are roof penetration, so I'm not even sure a plumber can plumb it. But anyway, we see piping diagrams like that. As you can see, I can't tell if this is reverse return or not. If we look at the next drawing here, they are calling for a quarter inch per foot of slope in the piping. That won't work as for reasons I've told you before. The down stub ends there, there are four of them, they're going to fill up and freeze, so you're going to have a mess with that system. The next thing they did, if you'll notice here, wait till it comes up. I don't want to talk past my slides here. There we go. The balancing valves that they put in there are in the return line. The balancing valves need to be in the supply line. If they're in the return line, you're pushing a bubble of air up to those valves, and you're going to get vapor lock and air lock to them. You want the valves down where you get a solid slug of water hitting the valves and then going through the collectors. So the balancing valves are on the wrong side. They should be on the supply side. All right, so let's move along and look at some piping diagrams for flat roofs, which is what most commercial is. The same rules apply to sloped roofs, but there's a little bit of different technology here. If you can get simple penetration, straight up, straight down, like the top picture, that's best. The piping, you want the piping off the roof as soon as you can get it off the roof. You've got it out of the rain, the weather, the ambient, cold ambient temperatures, and the stuff blowing on it. But the second bottom diagram shows if you can't do that, maybe there's only one spot where penetration will work. The chase is over there. So you run the supply line around the array, all the time maintaining the drain slope. And here's the principle. You want the return line to be the shortest line. You have a choice which way you tilt the bank. You can make the close end the high end or the far end the high end. And obviously, if you take the hot water and run it the shortest distance out in the weather, you're going to have less line loss. So it just makes common sense to make the return line be the shortest line. And I see this backwards many times. Okay, so here's two rows with two banks of five in each row. Notice the return lines there. We've got a little better close-up of it. The return lines drop from the front row immediately and the back row immediately. There is no single high point. Now we've got two high points, and we don't know if the back row is a half inch higher than the front row or 2 inches. I mean, you can't do construction any tighter than that. So what we've got is basically two independent systems. So this is reverse return on each row, but not between the two rows. So what do we do? Back over on the supply side, we've now got to put balancing valves in there. Those two red things, the red or brown things, are auto balancing valves. They're manual balancing valves, which are just a ball valve of some sort. And you can buy automatic balancing valves that have a spring-loaded plunger, and they are set for a certain gallons per minute, and they regulate the flow, they balance things. Why would you want to use those? Well, when you've got a half a dozen rows, balancing can be a royal pain in the neck. You change valve number one, and the flow changes through two, three, and four. You change number three, and it changes through one, two, and four. So these balancing valves, automatic balancing valves, stop all of that hassle and make it immediate. Here's another illustration coming up of a little more complicated system. This is three rows. This was designed to go on a dormitory in Boston, Massachusetts, downtown Boston, on a 100-year-old building. And there was not enough room to space the collectors out. So we had to go vertically with the different rows in order to keep from shading each other. And as you can see there on the near side to our view, the return lines are there. On the back side, you can just barely see the little brown knots in the line. They are the auto flow valves. But this is exactly the same piping scheme that we talked about before. We just added a balancing valve for each row. We can carry this ad infinitum. Here's a 100 collector array. It's shown in cutaway view, so we can see the piping. It's kind of tiny, but it's easy to understand. We tilted this array so the center of the array is the high point. So the outside edges are the low point. So we run the supply lines all the way out to the outside edges. So the cold supply line is the longest line by far, and the return lines are right there in the center dropping down. So this is an illustration. This is a 25 collector banks, four of them. If you had to do 1,000 collectors, you just keep making more rows and running down the center. So this is a way to do more and more rows using exactly the same techniques we referred to earlier. Okay, so a critical measure then when you're doing a flat roof thing is how to space the collector rows apart. We don't want row one shadowing row two and row two shadowing row three. So how do we decide, how do we calculate, how do we lay this thing out? First of all, you can go to a table, and I've shown the one here from NOAA's website, and I think they've changed it slightly, but it does the same thing. You can go there and look at December the 22nd. 21st and 22nd is the lowest sun angle of the year. It's the shortest day of the year. You pick a time of day at which you want the shading to be gone. There's no such thing as no shading because obviously as the sun comes up over the horizon is the first shading, and then you want to go so much higher in the sky to have full exposure of each row. A typical time of day is 9:30. Some people use 10 o'clock. So you can go fill out this form, pick December the 22nd, pick 9:30 a.m. or 9:30 24 hours, and then you look for the solar elevation. You don't want declination, you want elevation. Declination is of the Earth. So this says 19.38 degrees should be the shadow angle. So we want to make sure that the back row is far enough behind the front row that the maximum shadow angle is 19.38. Notice that this is tip-to-tip measurement. This is not between the rows. This is from the tip of the first row to the tip of the second row. So this is how we do the elevation calculation, the row spacing calculation. If you get into trouble, like we saw in that previous slide, where you don't have enough spacing for the third row, then you may have to elevate the rows so you can get that angle right. You may have to stagger them like stair steps. Let's look at a real example. This is the Warrior Transition Unit at the Bethesda Naval Base in Bethesda, Maryland. This is the hospital, newly built hospital that replaces Walter Reed Army Hospital in Washington, D.C. This is 50 collectors on the main building, two rows, 25 collectors in a row. Let's talk about this. Here's the penetration through the roof of the supply and return lines. The red line is the return coming back, the green line is the supply going out. Those pipes go over to the array, and off to the right is the supply going to the low end of the array. And here's the tricky part. The pipe has to continue to rise as the array continues to fall. So there's where we do our 1 inch and 20 feet down on the structural frame. But the supply pipe has to be going up at the same angle at least. Those are the minimum angles. And it works. You just have to pay attention. If you see that photo over on the right, you'll see the mechanism by which the contractor hung the piping. Did a very good job. The piping is off the roof. There are no stanchions on that piping. If you'll go back to this slide, you'll see that there's stanchions to get over to the array. Those are the black blocks on the roof that hold up the pipe. But once we get to the array, the piping can be supported off the array, and this is a very good thing. It allows you to re-roof under the array. You don't have to remove the collectors and the frame to completely re-roof this building. A lot of people set collector arrays right down on the roof with ballasted things and bags and blocks. If you need to do any re-roofing there, you've got a lot of deconstruction and reconstruction to do. It can be very expensive. So we try to get them up in the air far enough off the roof that re-roofing is very simple. If we go down to the far end of the array, this is the supply end, you'll see in that right-hand picture that 45-degree angle is where the auto flow valve is encapsulated. The line pops up to the back row, and you see the first supply line going in the first bank of collectors. The supply going to the other banks is underneath the collectors. It's also hung off the frame. And here, the next slide shows the supply piping going underneath the array, and the pipe size drops down, and we pop into every bank of five collectors with that elbow. Also notice that the stub end sitting there is completely insulated. We don't want any naked piping. We don't want any exposed copper piping anywhere. You can dump 50% of your energy if you don't pipe, if you don't insulate the pipes between the collectors. So we go from the second row up to the first row. Again, a very clever bracket holding the pipe out in the air going from the back row to the first. It doesn't touch the roof, no stanchions. You can work under it. And the front row is piped identically to the back row. That 45-degree angle down there is where the auto flow valve is. If we go around to the front of the array, you'll see the piping between collectors is completely insulated, and silicon rubber caulk or some good outdoor caulk, HVAC kind of caulk, is used to caulk the aluminum to the box. We don't want any water getting in around that insulation and soaking the insulation inside. People ask me, what is the maintenance of these guys? And I say, basically, you do an inspection of the caulking joints and you retouch them up as need be, so you don't leak, get rainwater in there and soak your insulation. Here's another shot showing the end of the first bank of five collectors. The return line goes up in the air, goes over all of the collectors to the far end. The next shot slide shows, there we go, shows the whole array, and that return line is running along the top of the collectors all the way to the far end. Those little vertical spikes are lightning arresters that the Navy decided they had to have on this system. Okay, when we get to the far end, here's a return pipe dropping down off of the front row. It drops down, and the second picture shows it going back to the back row, and they join together, and down it goes along the frame back to our starting point, back in the middle of the frame. So this is a good example of how to pipe 50 collectors in two rows and get it all to work right. So moving along now, let's talk about the fluid handling system that went in the basement. This is five stories down. The fluid handling system was 2,500 gallons. It is the insulated tank, the heat exchanger, pumps and controls and everything as a package. It went in the boiler room. You see on this slide, we using a multi-stage pump to do that five floors. It turns out that it takes about 0.8 horsepower, I think, to pump 35 or so GPM up five floors to those collectors. And that works out just fine. That is a fairly low horsepower. If you if it was a glycol system, the horsepower might be half that, maybe not. And if you take that marginal amount of horsepower, it might be, it wouldn't be half, it might be 15-20% less. If you take the performance benefit of 15% more and 30% longer life and getting rid of all the components, then this thing comes out of wash in terms of just pump horsepower, but it comes out ahead of the game in many other categories. So here it is installed, and you can see the pump's installed and the piping is connected to the heat exchanger and the controls are being wired. And there's the final tank in place. There we go. So we have the cold water lines to the heat exchangers on the front, and in the middle of the tank is where the collector supply and return come. That horizontal line that says makeup, we have an option of an autofill system. So we tap the cold water line to run over to the autofill system, which is in the middle of this tank, and it keeps the water level in the tank at the proper level, so you don't have to do any manual filling. It is a atmospheric pressure tank with a vent on it, so you have to maintain water level. It doesn't take much maintenance at all, but we've automated it here. Okay, let's look at performance. This is the day that we went up there to do the commissioning, and we fired the thing up at 10 a.m., and by 2:30 or so, we had raised the temperature 47 degrees. That's right at a million BTUs. So we put a million BTUs in an hour, in 4 hours into that system. Actually, it took about 15 minutes for the pump to pump water to the roof, so I think we can properly state that we got the million BTUs in 4 hours. All right, so here is now a circuit diagram. That's coming up on the next slide. All right, here's a full-blown circuit diagram of this kind of system. There's two different collector arrays up at the top showing the left-hand side would be if the collectors were parallel to a roof, like running up a shingle roof, and the right-hand array is what you do if you do the banks on a flat roof like we've been looking at. So let's look at that dotted line down at the bottom. That encapsulates what we call a fluid handling system. It is the insulated pump, it's the collector pump, it's the autofill system, the heat exchanger, and if you want BTU meters in the system, they go inside this package. Basically, what we do is tie into the cold water line in series with the cold water line. So if you see that DCW line going down there, it comes down to the junction with the two lines from the solar heat exchanger. We put a bypass or shutoff valve in between. The other two valves are isolation valves. You always want to isolate components so you can repair or work on them or replace them, especially those that are pressurized. By the way, you do not need isolation valves anywhere on the collector line because they're going to be empty when you turn it off. You really don't need any kind of valve to hold the water back. Okay, so let's follow the path of the cold water. It comes in DCW there, say on the left. It goes vertically down to that first line. It goes over to the tank through the heat exchanger. The water is preheated. It comes back over to the cold water line and heads down to the boiler inlet. The shutoff valve in the middle makes it mandatory that the water go over through the heat exchanger and come back. We can talk a little bit about controls at this point. If you look carefully, you'll see a T1 and a dot up there on the collectors. We put a temperature sensor up there. Most of them are thermistors. And we want to get it intimately tied into the collector loop. We have a graphic that simplifies this a little bit. Coming up now. There we go. Up at the last collector, the last output line, we take this little sensor, which is a cylinder with an end squished flat on it. We cram it under the grommet that goes into the collector, and then we use either some baling wire to tie it down or a band clamp. We don't want to crush the sensor inside that cylinder, so you have to be careful with a band clamp. That sensor has to do two different jobs. It has to read the temperature of the collectors under stagnation or static conditions. It has to determine when, it's half of the team that determines when to turn the solar on. But it almost must also read the dynamic operation of the sense of the system. When water is pumping through that thing, it's got to read fairly accurately the output temperature of the water. Occasionally, people will put that T1 sensor out on the line 4, 5, 6 inches away from the collector. That's the wrong place for it. It needs to be just as tight to the collector as you can get it. When you put it out on the line, it does not read the static temperature as well as it should. It probably reads dynamic okay, but it doesn't read static very well. The second sensor is the one down at the bottom called T2, and it reads the cold water going to the collectors, or pretty close to it. So you're now reading roughly the inlet water going to the collector and the outlet water going to the collector. In static condition, when the collectors heat up 18 degrees hotter than the tank water, the cold, the low part of the tank, then it turns the collector pump on and it runs and you run through your cycle. At the end of the, it runs continuously until the end of the day or a cloud cover or rain shower. And if the collectors fall within about 5 degrees of the tank, you turn it off. Now you say, why turn off at 5? Why not go to 0? Well, we've got to leave a little margin in there for line losses. So we might lose a couple of percent in the lines, so we just pick a number that's not quite 0 to turn the pump off. And then the last item there is we set the high limit, which is reading the T2 sensor, at 160, it turns the pump off. Now one thing that's not mentioned here, or it is mentioned over on the left, is the dead band. Once we turn the system off at 160, we don't want it turning back on at 159. It'll just sit there and cycle all day long, burn the pump up. So we have a dead band of 15 degrees. That means until somebody takes some water heat out of the system and drops the tank temperature 15, the pump cannot turn back on. So that dead band is just more or less an equipment safety to keep from sitting there short cycling and burning up the pump. All right, we've got an individual drawing here that shows the mechanism for the autofill system. It's basically a float sitting on top of the water and a solenoid valve to turn on when the float says to turn on. So there's no real rocket science here. We have had some trouble in the field with trash gumming up the solenoid valve, so we recommend, and it's not shown on here, we recommend a good quality strainer to keep trash from sticking that solenoid valve and making the system overflow and dumping water down the drain. We've also had people that will turn the power off to that, and then manually they'll eyeball the sight glass, manually turn it on. It'll still automatically fill it to level and shut it off, and then they turn the power back off. So there's 100 options as to how to use that, and we'll keep you posted as we figure out improvements to this thing. The BTU meter system is basically a flow sensor in the domestic hot water heat exchanger line and two temperature sensors. So flow rate and difference in temperature are how you calculate BTUs. It's not really a control as mentioned there, but it is an electronic device that a lot of people are using on commercial systems. Back in the 80s, there was no such thing as a highly automated BTU system. Now there is, and this is one big jump we've had in technology since the first bloom of solar in the 70s and 80s. There are lots of applications for solar hot water. Preheating domestic hot water is one. Forced air furnaces, space heating, and there's three different kinds of space heating: forced air furnace, radiant slab, radiant baseboard. There's processed hot water. A car wash is processed hot water. There's textile baths for where the dye baths where you have hot water for that. There's even wash down water in restaurants where you take a hot water hose and you wash the tile floor down to the drain. So there are all kind of uses for processed hot water, domestic hot water. It is the lowest hanging fruit for giving a good energy value to the customer in very many cases. Let's talk about space heating for a minute. You can put a water coil in the return air side of the ductwork. If you control the blower, the burner, and the solar pump all together, you can make the solar contribute a lot of energy to the space heating. There are three operating modes. If the solar tank's hot as a firecracker, you kick on the space heating pump, you kick on the blower, you heat the building only with the solar. When the solar tank falls below a threshold at which it can do the whole load, then you simply turn on the regular furnace and the solar preheats the air just like it preheats water in the domestic hot water system. So you preheat the air and the furnace carries the load. Then the third mode is the solar tank temperature continues to drop, and when the temperature of the tank is below return air temperature, room air temperature, you just turn the solar off and the furnace runs by itself. So those are three operating modes that allow you to get run that temperature of the solar tank way down, get all the heat out of that tank. Makes it much more efficient to operate that way. Okay, radiant slab. There are various ways to do radiant slab. The top drawing shows a case where if you ignored the solar and it weren't in the loop, it's a smaller system and the boiler pump runs the loop. So the boiler kicks on, the pump kicks on, hot water goes through the loop. If you add solar to it, then you just you tap it into the coldest return line in the system. You always want solar on the coldest side of the system. And you have to enable the solar pump to run when the boiler pump has run it. So you basically put a relay in there that says, okay, you can run if you want to. And then the solar controls will say, okay, the solar water is hotter than the return line. It's a delta T controller, basically. And you feed solar into that line when you can, and the boiler finishes it. The bottom drawing shows a slightly more sophisticated system where you have a loop pump. The pump that pumps that floor is a separate pump from the boiler pump. So now the boiler and the solar are basically parallel things doing exactly the same thing. We call that a sidearm. The water in the loop goes by the boiler and goes by the solar, and you can contribute some solar to it by turning the solar pump on. You can contribute to it with the boiler by turning the boiler on. So those are the two separate ways to do radiant slab heating. Now, if you'll notice, there's no heat exchanger in these two solar tanks, and there was no heat exchanger in the previous space heating tank. If you can get a boiler loop system, a radiant slab system, if the boiler can operate at atmospheric pressure, it doesn't have to be a pressurized loop, you can usually get away with no heat exchanger in the solar tank. And if you think about it, you didn't spend the money for the heat exchanger, you don't have the efficiency loss for the heat exchanger. That is really a very efficient way to put solar heat in the floor. There are some boilers, however, that demand that they work at a pressure. They can't work at atmospheric pressure. Well, okay, so we stick a heat exchanger in the solar tank and we do the same thing anyway. So you can do it either of those two ways, either in forced air, radiant slab, radiant baseboard, with or without a heat exchanger in the solar tank. So how do you do a pool system? Well, this picture in the middle, here we go, okay. This picture in the middle shows a typical circulator, a pool system with a circulator loop. It's like the boiler loop. You've got your pump and your chlorinator or brominator or whatever chemicals you put in there, and it's looping the pool water. So you tie that into a solar pool heat exchanger, and you have a solar pool pump on there, and you turn it on when the pool pump is running. Again, you have that relay at the bottom is a lockout relay. It's the same kind of thing. You only allow the solar to run if the pool circulator is running. And you have a delta T controller that says the solar is hotter than the pool water. And so I'm going to turn on, if the pool pump is running, I'm going to turn on the solar and put some heat into it. the little drawing up there in the upper right is if you've got a small pool or spa and you can get taps directly to it, then that's the simplest of all hookups to the solar. You just hook it directly to the pump and heat exchanger in the solar loop. So those are two different ways you can hook into a pool system. We've hooked into things that go from commercial pools, a county public park swimming pool, all the way down to little pools and spas in people's houses. And you use either one of these two circuits to do that. So what have we talked about? Well, we talked about how to design a system with the best characteristics. We settled on drain back. We've talked about collector arrays and how to pipe them. We've talked about the controls and what they're sensing and where they're sensing it. And we talked about different applications we can use for solar hot water. So this is wraps up this portion of our webinar today. And we'll turn it back over to Charlie and see if there are questions on this or other questions we can answer.